It's wonderful to welcome you to our worship this morning. I should have been joining you physically in the building as we worshipped this morning, but we're still in the situation where we are worshipping online here with St George's Wilton. So thank you for having me. I look forward to joining you physically soon, but as we turn to worship now, let's just pause and remember in whose presence we are. The Lord is here. His Spirit is with us. And so we turn to worship now as we join together in lifting our hearts in praise to Him.
Alone, my hope is. How's your week been?
It's been a very different week, hasn't it? Hairdressers are opened, I'm booked in, the pubs are opened, I've already been in. And for those who share my deep spirituality, I'm glad to be able to say that Formula One Grand Prix racing is back in. Lots of things seem to be returning, but despite all that, on the whole, life still seems rather strange, different, still have social distancing and queues and face coverings. And of course, we're now in the planning stages of reopening St. George's for a gathered service where we can meet together in the building on a Sunday morning. I know that the church wardens, Bethan and the PCC, are looking at the details of that and will keep you updated. But in all likelihood, within the next 2 or 3 weeks, we may be able to start having a Sunday morning service here in the church. And at the same time, we'll have a second service which will continue online. And perhaps for the foreseeable future, we'll continue with a service in church and a service online. The thing that we need to keep in mind is that, be it in the building or be it on the internet, the wonderful truth will always remain that the Lord is here and His Spirit is with us. Even in lockdown, I've managed to do things that I ought not to have done. And I failed to do many things that I ought to have done. And if we say we have no sin, well, the Bible tells us that the truth isn't in us, we deceive ourselves. But this is accompanied by that wonderful promise that if we confess our sins, if we do business with God and say we're sorry, if we bring our sins to the cross, then God will be faithful and God will forgive us. God will give us a new start. He will cleanse us. It's a fresh start when we come to the cross, when we come before God with those things that we've done, which we shouldn't have done, and with those things which we should have done, which we've failed to do. So I invite you to join me this morning as we use the Coventry Prayer of Reconciliation for our confession. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. The hatred which divides nation from nation, race from race, class from class. Father, forgive. The covetous desires of people and nations to possess what is not their own. Father, forgive. The greed which exploits the work of human hands and lays waste the earth. Father, forgive. Our envy of the welfare and happiness of others. Father, forgive. Our indifference to the plight of the imprisoned, the homeless, the refugee. Father, forgive. The lust which dishonours the bodies of men, women and children. Father, forgive. The pride which leads us to trust in ourselves and not in God. Father, forgive. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. Almighty God, who forgives each one of us when we say sorry, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, and keep us all in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so as a forgiven people, let's strive in the command of God's word and in the power of God's Holy Spirit, let's strive to build a better world, a more caring community, a more equal society. And let's not be discouraged or dissuaded by the difficulties of the present pandemic or the challenges of the lockdown recovery. For God is able to work good from all things. And who knows, even some of the difficulties, even some of the pains, even some of the challenges which have frustrated us, who knows that they may not hold out new blessings, new opportunities, new mercies.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while, you hear each spoken need. Yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? Pray for wisdom, your voice to hear. And we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not.
This morning's reading is taken from Matthew chapter 13, the parable of the sower. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they didn't have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
When I was a very young child, I remember being propped up in my pram, big silver cross affair, in the garden with my mum, listening with mother. Do you remember that programme on Radio 4, Listen with Mother? An opportunity to hear a familiar story and to have it amplified with activities and songs that told more of the tale. Our gospel reading today is a bit like that. It's one of those very familiar stories. The parable of Jesus telling a tale of a farmer sowing seed. An everyday sight which his hearers would have recognised from their own experience. And though through the story, Jesus brings out some messages to explain what his ministry is really all about. Jesus calls his disciples, his followers, to listen carefully as he tells the tale. And as he explains it and its meaning, he invites them to hear, to really hear what is behind the words. In fact, he uses that word hear as the deeper meaning in itself. Seed the sower throws are words themselves. Words that tell of the kingdom of God and God's love. And it's the listeners who really hear the words, who receive the words, who accept the messages that are those which evidence fruit. And there's a big difference between listening and hearing, isn't there? I still listen a lot to Radio 4, at home when I'm waking up or in my car as I travel. But how much do I really hear? Or how much is merely background noise? Jesus has been out and about. He's been healing and preaching and teaching. The miracles brought him to the attention of people. And so as they gathered, they were looking for signs and wonders. They were anticipating them. And it was his opportunity then to talk about things of God. The crowds that day were large. He had to get into a boat, we're told, in order to be seen and heard. And here he is using this story to explain that deep listening, really grasping what has been said will produce fruit in people's lives. Jesus is saying that the fruit will be grown where the soil is good, the ground fertile and receptive to what is planted. So what does that really mean for us? During this pandemic, we've found ourselves without the usual props to our faith, haven't we? Shut out of our buildings and unable to receive the sacraments. And for some of us, that has made us feel ourselves as if on stony ground. Where are the roots, the foundations of our faith? So much has felt as though it's shifted, hasn't it? A very real sense of fragility. For others of us, we may have found the anxieties of health, the stresses of finance, the uncertainty of the future has crowded in upon us and strangled our hope, a bit like those weeds, the good seed. The resurrection life, the power and energy of the Holy Spirit have been hard to hold on to at a time when everything feels suspended or in limbo. But there has been fruit, hasn't there? Even in this period of disturbance and unsettledness, it's almost as if the ground has been turned over, ploughed up, if you like, and in some places, fertilised. I've been so struck by the stories that I've heard of prayer deepening. People gathering online, not just for worship together, but for prayer together. Sometimes even on a daily basis. Patterns of prayer have been established in homes, a renewed vigour in our own personal prayer lives. It's exciting. And it's not just for those of us of faith, is it? For whom faith has always played a part. It's also recognised in some of those for whom the news of God's love is fresh and revolutionary. They've not heard it before. One of our deanery leaders was just telling us this week that he'd had the privilege of leading someone to Christ who lives abroad, someone who's never experienced Jesus before or known of his love, a resident in Bangkok, joining their regular worship online and discovering the love of Jesus through the welcome he's received through the congregation. And that speaks to me of fertile ground. As the pandemic continues, but we begin to move back into our church buildings and resume life in some degree of normality, how might we recognise the quality of the ground within our church communities? In the Church of Bath and Wells, are we good soil or are we stony and hard? Are we ready for growth or are we cold and resistant to it? Will we be receptive to hear God's call to us to grow, to transform, to become fruitful, evidencing the love of Christ in abundant ways? And how about the climate of our world? How might we describe that? Is it fertile ground, longing for meaning and God's warmth? Or is it inward-looking and prone to be choked by distractions of life? There have been a lot of surveys, haven't there? It's been a time to assess how we as a world have responded to the pandemic and what that says to us about the type of society we are or want to be. The concerns that we have, the values that we hold. Many are pointing to a greater spiritual openness, whilst recognising a growing distrust of institutions, even the church, where once leadership, perhaps in answering those big questions, could be sought. And we as a diocese are hoping to do a more in-depth listening, a deeper listening in the weeks to come. So do please look out for that opportunity to join in and share in that. How might we learn more about the world around us? You see, we need to understand more of what motivates people, what hurts them, where their anxieties are expressed, if we're truly to offer words of hope. Such listening will inform our thinking about how we live and tell the story of Jesus and his love for the world, and our engagement then with it. We need to learn to read the environment today and act in a way that brings growth, growth for the kingdom. So while we might speculate about the new norm or a world beyond COVID-19, we're also called to be diligent and faithful to the work the sower is doing among us here and now. As we go about our work, our leisure, we take the seeds of the gospel with us and plant them. Maybe that's in a quick word with someone or an act of kindness. Or maybe it's really listening to how someone feels. we bring the comfort of the gospel to them. Maybe it's about praying for a particular person or a situation. God may even call us to see the growth happening before us. God calls us to this sowing project with him. He's the ultimate sower, and to some extent we might think of ourselves as the seed, the carriers of the words of the kingdom. Jesus used this same metaphor of seed in another way when he said these words, didn't he? Unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains but a single grain with no life. He, Christ, died for us so that we can share his abundant life with others. Sometimes it may be costly, but always it will be rewarding.
My shelter.
Lord God, you are the Father of all people, and we bring our prayers knowing that you will hear us and help us. We pray for the whole family of your church in all parts of the world. Give courage to those who find it hard to follow you, to those who are finding it difficult to have faith because of a personal hardship or tragedy, particularly those whose loved ones have recently died from the coronavirus. And we pray that your voice will be heard. Lord, how much we need to hear your voice, how much we need you now in our world. Let your Holy Spirit support all of us and help all Christians to stand firm in the hope that your kingdom of love will come. Lord, you are our hope. We put our trust in you. Lord, you know how hard it is to sow the seeds of your love where people are struggling for their very lives, particularly in parts of Africa where there is political instability, famine, and continued fighting. We pray for the aid agencies who continue to work alongside these people to bring help in the form of healthcare and food. It's easy in the midst of our own worries about the coronavirus to forget those who are also suffering in different ways. Lord, you are our hope. We put our trust in you. We thank you and pray for Bishop Ruth here with us this morning. We pray for our bishops and clergy who are doing what they can to support and strengthen us during this difficult time. As we start to move forward to meet once again into our church buildings, we pray that we may do it safely and in ways that help those who are still unsure about attending. May they be reassured that this is not a problem and that we and God will understand their reticence. Lord, we give thanks for all those who have worked so hard to complete our church profile. We pray that this process is in your hands and that already seeds are being sown in the heart of the person that you have in mind for St. George's, and that they will respond positively to the advertisement. Lord, you are our hope. We put our trust in you. Creator God, we are your chosen stewards of this beautiful world. You provide us with seed and soil to sow them in. But sometimes we abuse this privilege. And so we look to you for forgiveness for the damage we have done to this earth, and pray that you would show us ways of healing the wounds that we have inflicted on the land, ourselves and on each other. Lord, unselfishness does not come naturally to us, but if we're going to save our planet, then we have to learn to work together, to share our resources, our ideas, and our expertise. Please give us the grace to do that. Lord, you are our hope. We put our trust in you. Father, we pray for those who are lonely at this time, the elderly, those working alone at home, single-parent families. We know that loneliness exacerbates health problems and leads to anxiety and mental health. We pray too for young people missing their friends and normal social life, some of whom have really suffered during these past 4 months of lockdown, not being able to go to school. We pray particularly for those who've been stuck in their bedrooms, bored and unmotivated, and not wanting to engage in the studies that have been set for them online. We pray for boys and girls in primary school who really miss playing football and the rough and tumble of being with their friends. They are also having to learn a whole new set of rules that can have mixed messages and be very confusing. Father, as the summer holidays approach, we pray that they may be able to be out more and meet up sensibly with their friends, enjoying more freedom with their families, to return refreshed to start school again in September. Lord, you are our hope. We put our trust in you. Father, when we are ill, take from us the fear which will not let us remember your loving care. And when we are well, help us never to forget to give thanks for our health and strength. So today, we pray for those who are suffering, who are in pain, and finding life really hard. Be close to them, Lord, and may they know that you will never leave. We pray for loved ones and friends whom we know well, who have died recently. We remember them with great affection and love, giving thanks for all that they gave during their lifetime. We pray for you. We pray for and ask you to comfort their family and friends who are missing them. Lord, you are our hope. We put our trust in you. Finally, Lord Jesus, we want to believe in our Father's wonderful plan for the world. But such is the pressure of evil that often we are tempted to give up hope. Help us, Lord Jesus, however gloomy the forecast, never to give up hope in the possibility of fulfillment of our Father's joyful plan for us and all creation. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
O Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. When through the world and forest glades I wander, and hear the birds sing sweetly in the trees. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. That God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross, my burdens gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Saviour God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Saviour God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. And when Christ shall come, with shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Saviour God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, Saviour God, to Thee. How great Thou art, how great Thou art, how great Thou art, how great Thou
It's been wonderful to worship with you here today. Whether you're regular congregation members of St. George's, or whether you have gathered across the miles to join in with this service, we thank you and we pray that God will go with you. So as we end this service, just as we begun, we remember the presence of Christ going with us. So may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be with you, remain with you always, all whom you love, all whom you pray for. Amen.
Well, thank you for being with us this morning. And if you're with us in real time, that is here on Sunday morning rather than later in the day or later in the week on catch up, then please do continue and enjoy a coffee and a live chat with us after this service live on Zoom. In the absence of virtual refreshments, we provide the Zoom, you simply provide your coffee. We will be meeting again online next Sunday at 10 o'clock. When I'm so looking forward to sharing with you as we look in the Bible at the marks of mission. A consideration of how God's word calls his church to mission, calls his church to reach out. And a challenge for us as to how we respond to that call. A checklist to if we are indeed responding to that call. That call that God's amazing grace calls out to all people, calls out to people of every tribe, tongue and nation. That in the kingdom, in the economy of God, every life matters, every life is valued, every life is dearly loved, and every life is invited to be part of what God is doing here on earth, so that we might join him in heaven. And so our closing hymn is a focus on that amazing grace that God holds out to you and to me. I look forward to seeing you next week.
Sing with me, and can it be?
And can it be that I should again have an interest in the Saviour's blood? Died he for me, who caused his pain?
Shine on.